Hey, it's Ben here from Skates.co.uk. I'm in Wales, it's D-Side, the Ice State World Championships, and I'm with Ben Grantham.
Hi.
Right, so we've got an international who's who list of people this weekend. Ben's pretty well known, he's been in the industry for years. He's done stuff with loads of people, including Razor, Scoop Nation. You now do some French Toast as well.
Yeah.
So tell me a little bit more about that.
Well, I've been into magazine writing ever since I started off with Scoop Mag. You know, I was helping them with ideas for articles, and I contributed a bit as well. I did the things I did with them, and then I moved on to Scoop Nation. They're really enthusiastic to have me on board, and they took a lot of my ideas, and I really helped them develop the magazine because it's very under-established, so I helped them get more well-known. And then at the same time, I did stuff with French Toast as well because, I like the French Toast movement.
Tell me a little bit more about the movement. What do you mean by that?
Well, I'd say the French Toast is a different kind of magazine to the other ones. It's more about, well, it's aimed at the mature rider for starters, but yeah. It's also about teaching the younger ones. And I kind of just like the vibe that you get with French Toast. It's all about the lifestyle, the culture, the scooter riding rather than just the sport and the industry.
Sure, okay. So.
I'm happy to do stuff for them, so.
Yeah, I like French Toast. When I look at it, artistically, aesthetically, it's a great looking magazine.
Yeah.
My issue has always been translation with those guys. I mean, what do you bring to the table, what do you do with them?
Well, I've already said that I'll help them out doing some language patching, and they're keen for me to do that. But with regards to the image thing, I totally agree. The thing I like with French Toast is every single one is different. If you notice all the page layouts and stuff, which is really good. So it's not just like the same thing all the time, just interchanging articles and photos. It's completely new,
yeah.
Each time, every time, which is great.
Well, those French guys, I mean, the whole French scooter scene, they're all little arty guys, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and it's a lifestyle thing, which I like. And that's something scootering, it's slowly developing. So you're getting it with clothing, shoes, brands.
Absolutely, always possible, exo-wear.
So. There you go. It's slowly, like skateboarding, it's slowly coming up around. You're getting a whole lifestyle kind of thing around it, which is awesome.
Yeah, I think it's great.
One of the things I really, really enjoy is so many guys I know have started their own clothing kind of company and doing designs and stuff. Some of them are rubbish, I'll be honest with you. Some are really, really cool. And it's really cool to see 15, 16, 17 year olds go, I want to design something, I want to be something, I want to start this. Because every big skateboarding company started like that, you know. Mm. They just start with some guy going, I skate, I do this, I want to make something cool. And it's so fresh when you see someone just come out of this cool design.
Yeah, it's great when all these people get together with their ideas. I mean, like all this possible stuff, it was designed by Damien Capozzi. He did the artwork, he did some of the artwork on the Addict decks.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah, so, and obviously they discussed their ideas with Maxime, Jody, to get some really good designs together, as well as Kevin DeMay. They're all the people kind of pushing that side of things with brands like these, and Eric Gravel with the Exodwear. So yeah, it's great.
You're an encyclopedia of knowledge, let's face it. I mean,
thank you.
You've worked with everyone, you know everyone, and you're, in a way, the UK, you're one of the most well-known UK people. There may be some controversy there, but it's still, because I don't want to say you're a polarizing person, but you are who you are, you're uncompromising and you're honest. And sometimes that doesn't work
well. Yeah, like the honesty thing is kind of the big one for me. Like, I'd rather, you know, be honest about what I think rather than kind of be two-faced in a way.
Yeah. And that's a good thing.
I mean, but yeah, like, just 7 years in the sport. I mean, I started in 2005.
Okay.
Beginning in 2005. So I've literally seen, in the UK, I've seen the sport, like, go from here, like, all the way to here. Like, the growth has been absolutely exponential. Like, I wouldn't have believed it, you know, that long ago, that it would be what it is now. I mean, I'm sitting in a room having an interview with, like, the biggest scooter event to date, I believe.
Yep.
So it's amazing.
So you've done some stuff, and you continue to do some stuff with Razor. Tell me more about their kind of their Phase Two stuff. What's the idea behind the new rebranding of Phase Two?
Well, as we all know, Razor's a well-established brand. You know, it's had 12 years brand equity. So I think what Ali Kamani, like the man behind Phase Two, with John Radke, and you know all the riders, what they wanted to do is kind of make some kind of divide, so shy away from kind of the whole Razer thing, because Razer's branding is very versatile, because it has to be, because, you know, they're making scooters, quad bikes, pogo sticks, all these kind of things, and it's aimed at kind of the younger audience, whereas they want something which can be aimed at, you know, the mature rider, but also appeals to the little kids as well, because sure. when you aim a product at, you know, younger kids, it kind of alienates the older riders, whereas if you aim the product at the older riders, you kind of capture that audience, but you also get the younger ones as well, because the younger kids' perception of coolness tends to be what the older riders find cool, so, you know, the more mature brands.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But yeah, phase two is just about, you know, riders first.
Yeah.
The great thing about phase two is all the riders involved, they all have some kind of skill that they put towards phase two. So, for instance, John Radke, he's really good at graphic design, you know, he's been doing the logo, he's been doing some of the artwork as well. Johan's been he's been working with John to design some parts and cater to the European street scene. Ali's been wanting me to help out with stuff in here. But a few other things as well. We're still talking about it.
Yeah.
But yeah, every rider's going to bring quality. I mean, even the Team Razer UK guys, they're promoting the products in the Phase 2 and still the Razer products as well as the Royce King from Razer Australia, Phil Ligeti. They're all working on it. So it's a work in progress, but it's going to be good when it all gets developed and everybody comes together.
It's really exciting times, because 2012, you've now got all these guys who've been riding for a long time, and now adults, and now can really start kind of developing their brand and growing the market and things they're interested in. So it's now less about business guys selling stuff, more about people who have actually grown up doing something and are passionate about it.
Yeah, I think it's great, like, all the older riders are still doing something, and even some of the older riders are coming back, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesse Macaluso's back, he's releasing footage. Chris Bartnicki with Whip Scooters, which is something like kind of the only the OG riders will understand. So he's coming back and doing stuff. So yeah, it's great. I mean, Eric Rebel's bringing Exogwear back, because that was pretty popular around 2007, 2008. So yeah, it's great that all these older riders are still finding a place in the sport, and it's not just being replaced by you know, different kind of people, like businessmen coming in, and, you know, the younger riders growing up and wanting to do something for the sport. So yeah, it's great. It's great that all kinds of people are you know, going towards the same direction.
Good. Well, we're at the Ice Age. We should probably talk about the Ice Age.
Of course.
We talked about everything else. So, are you riding today? Do you plan on riding?
Yeah, I mean, I rode yesterday. Like, I haven't actually rode the skate park before. But, you know, I love it. It's a really good skate park, and I'll probably try my best in the competition when I get the chance to ride. So, yeah, I'm excited, and, you know, it's amazing how this has all come together. So, major props to Phil Grice from the ISA, and everybody who's put their efforts towards this, because it's really paid off, you know. Everybody's having such a great time.
He's worked his ass off.
Yeah,
and he's such a nice guy, he's dedicated. It's nice meeting someone who's dedicated.
Yeah.
Where do you see the Ice Age in a couple of years? I mean, what do you see happening?
I'm really not sure, to be honest. I kind of want to ask Phil what all these kind of meetings are about, if he's willing to tell me. Because I want to know what he's doing with all these, right? Like, because there's a lot of different companies.
Yeah.
Like, no two companies are the same realistically. So there's all different kinds of companies. You know, companies for the younger riders, and, you know, ones for the older riders, such as Addict and District and whatnot. So I want to see. I'm interested in what there is for all of them to agree on. You know, apart from you know, making the money and growing the market, there's got to be some other things as well. You know, for the riders, I'm sure there's something. And I'm excited to hear all about it, hopefully.
Yeah. Well, I can't tell you nothing. I missed that meeting. I was 4 hours late to Wales.
Yeah, it started as soon as I got here, so... And I probably wouldn't be allowed in anyway. But yeah, it'll be interesting to hear about it, and it'll be clear. We'll know about it, presumably, if they've got some stuff to act on.
Yeah. Anyway, it's exciting days. Tomorrow we're gonna find out what the world champion is, you know?
Yeah, that is exciting. Like, in my opinion, there has been a lot of competitions in the UK you know, we've had X-Fest, the Razor Global Domination Tour, we've had NAS, you know, as the finals, we've had Scoot Fest, and now we have the ISA.
Yeah.
So there's constantly, you know, a new podium, like a new, you know, number one. All the riders are trying to get it, and Dakota Schutz has been making a real effort to try get to the top of the podium.
Yeah.
Because that's how he is.
Do you think he's going to win?
Ooh, well, I left the skate park early to go out with the Dissidents and Ethic guys, but I was checking Facebook, constantly checking the updates. They've got like a live feed going on, and the things they said he was doing, it's unbelievable. I mean, I watched some of the footage as well, you know, him sending, I think it was a downside heel whip to double bri flip, like a backside. That's insane. Every time he comes to a skate park, he's sending a new world's first or something. You know, it's interesting. I wonder what goes through his head when he's doing all this kind of stuff. At the age of 16 as well.
Yeah. The first time I met him, and every time I see him, he reminds me of Ivan Drago from Rocky IV. He's called the machine.
Yeah,
he's like this machine. It's like, well, I spoke to him and I was like, how often did you ride? You know, what do you want? He goes, I ride every day for 4 hours. I go to school. I ride, and that's my day.
I actually heard that he's educated at home.
He is. So
yeah, and his dad's I think his dad's an excellent coach. So I think I don't think he pushes him at all. Absolutely not. But I think he does give him some motivation. You know, he does support him a lot. You know, coming with him to all these places. You know, filming him, all that kind of stuff. So
yeah.
it's a family thing as well. I mean, his brother Hunter as well. Like, they're pushing each other to ride.
Hunter's good.
Yeah, he's good, and he's a nice kid as well. They're both nice kids.
Yeah.
Well-mannered, you know.
Very, very, very polite.
And they love the sport, so.
So, there's one guy that, so Dakota has been doing amazing this year. This year is basically Dakota.
Yeah.
But there's been a guy who has not been around the entirety of this year, and he'll be back next year.
Absolutely.
Tyler
Bonner.
How is he going to, because in some way, as good as Coda is, he's not really been facing off against Tyler, so is he the best in the world?
I wouldn't give any excuse as to why Coda's been winning, apart from the fact that he's been trying really hard, he's been really consistent in his runs. I mean, he's been facing off against Raymond Warner, you know, some of the great USA riders, you know, and some of our guys, and some of the Australians as well, I put it to his skill and commitment as well.
I'm not saying he's not amazing as he is, but I'm just interested to see what happens next year. And as well, where Ryan Mack has done so well this year.
Absolutely, I've been reading some of his interviews recently. Like, it's amazing. He's made it to the top in a way.
Yeah, he has. He was amazing at the beginning of the year, but he's been on form the last 6 months.
Mm.
So that's exciting. I'm excited about my rider, Rhys Prince. I really love Rhys, and I think next year is his year. I really do. Todd Grady thinks the same thing, and Todd's opinion, I think Todd's opinion gets theirs, so we're going to see on that one. But it's exciting times, and as much as I think Cody's going to win tomorrow, I think anyone could win as well. It doesn't surprise me.
Absolutely.
It just takes one bad run, or one bad move. He doesn't land something. He does like Billy, breaks his ankle, game over, and this thing's wide open. Just like that.
But I don't think I've ever heard of him breaking a bone or having an injury or something.
He's padded up.
I was speaking to him about it, and like he kind of, it's not like he's learning how to do a trick every time. He's learning not to fall over in a way. So it's like the other way around. He's learning not to make a mistake. So, I mean, he does fall off like now and again, like on a blue moon, on a leap year.
Yeah.
But, but
stars align.
He knows how to get himself out of trouble.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen it. You know, he just, something wrong happens and just get out of it.
Where he's so consistent, he practices being so consistent. I always think that there's 10 world firsts that he's already done at home that he's not even revealed yet, and it's like, I need to bring something big out of the bag and do this one.
It's an effective method. Yeah. You know, he's always got something to bring out of his sleeve.
Yeah.
So yeah, and I'm definitely sure we're gonna see something like that this weekend, again and again and again.
Yep. That jaws will be on the floor with that guy, totally.
Yeah.
It's been great challenging, Ben. chat for ages.
Yeah, we have. We've done all sorts of topics.
We've travelled around. don't forget to subscribe. Ben Grantham. Thanks for being here. And more interviews coming this way. Thanks a lot. Bye.